but they very strongly resonate with a particular philosopher named Dharmakirti, who says at the beginning of, so he talks about the idea that when we are actually what we would call in the Buddhist context, what's called knowledge is really an event. It sort of doesn't exist independent of minds. So it's an event in a mind. It's called a jnana, and or more precisely, samyak jnana, a correct event of this kind, a correct cognitive event. And he says, one of the things he famously says is samyak jnana purvikav sarva purusharta siddhi, the accomplishment of all human aims, which is basically kind of the good life, right? This, what this is really pointing to, what we want in a considered way, that's always preceded by correct knowledge or correct cognition. And the other thing he says is, and how do you get to these correct cognitions? You do that by using what are called instruments of knowledge or instruments of knowing, and in Sanskrit that's called pramana, and it's based on a word that is actually very deliberately understood to have to do with the instrumental case in Sanskrit. So it's something, the means by which you come to this kind of correct knowledge. And how is he going to define that? He says that it is avisambhada, which means in Tibetan milua, which means that it is non-belying. And this is a kind of, if you're in a conversation with someone and they're trying to trick you, they're going to do visambhada. It's as if they're making a promise, but they're not. So this is not failing to keep a promise, so to speak, as a metaphor. And then he defines avisambhada as artakriya stitihi, which means conforming to effective action. In other words, what it means for knowledge to be correct is that it is efficacious. And I'm going to say something about how that works out, what it means for it to be efficacious, because it actually gets, it very much sounded like, what was it in Peirce, reality is, or our concept of reality is basically what we think it, what its causal effects on us are. And that's exactly, almost precisely Dharmakirti's account, especially of concept formation. Although he also says we can form other kinds of concepts that are completely unrelated to any real things, because we just have this mechanism of our mind and we can spin out concepts pointlessly as well, and they're often not very useful for any purpose. When the one he cites, an apologist to you theists out there, is the idea of God, actually, as one of them. But who knows if he's right? God does know, just kidding. So I want to talk about a little bit about that sort of position, that Dharmakirti's theory, because I think it'll help us in some ways to understand the relevance of this material, which I think is very relevant to a lot of Buddhist philosophy. But I also want to then briefly, before I do that, touch base a little bit on sort of his opponents, which you could think of as being sort of dogmatists. Actually, there were skeptics too, but there were dogmatists, and then I want to refer also to a notion that's called objectivism in sort of contemporary scholarship. And one of the people who uses that term is Mark Johnson. And they might be a kind of subset of these dogmatists, you could say. And the reason I want to raise the idea of objectivism is that it's very relevant to the way in which we appropriate science, especially in the context of Buddhism. So one of the interesting phenomena over the last couple of centuries has been the rapprochement between Buddhism and science, and that rapprochement has generally been a very a cozy one, right? That relationship has been a very positive one in some ways for both sides, but maybe especially for Buddhists. There are various works out there by Don Lopez and by David McMahon that are cultural histories of the relationship between Buddhism and science, and the way in which Buddhism in some ways has been, you might even say, kind of packaged as scientific in itself. But also there's a way in which we have His Holiness the Dalai Lama, for example, has a specific kind of relationship, very interesting and important relationship with science, where we talked about yesterday him being willing to completely throw out Mount Meru, this traditional cosmological category, and abandon the traditional cosmology because it doesn't stand up to scientific inquiry. Now, when one way we can, of course, one set of reactions within Buddhism, and I've seen this in various contexts, is actually a great suspicion of science, and that science is somehow going to take away our precious spirituality. This is clearly not His Holiness the Dalai Lama's way of interacting with science, and I'm going to presume that's not a problem. I mean, that's that to my mind is a problematic stance. It leads to, it really does not align very well with Buddhist philosophy, at least. But there is another possibility, actually, that can sneak in the back door, which is a kind of objectivist appropriation of science, or appropriation of science as a kind of objectivism. And objectivists were the, various kinds of objectivists, direct realists and so on, were the opponents of Buddhist philosophers in India. And the philosophy we find that comes to Tibet is a philosophy that develops in opposition to a great extent to those kinds of positions. And one of the ways I fell asleep, so I couldn't put my slides up, but Mark Johnson, for example, defines objectivism, and I'll just roughly replicate it, that we can have a notion that there is a bird's eye view of reality, and there's just one account, therefore, of that reality. And that bird's eye view has to do with entities, discrete entities in the world that have certain kinds of structures and that interrelate in certain kinds of ways. That, and our concepts and the mathematical and logical operations we use to interrelate our concepts all map perfectly onto those objects and their interrelations. So, for example, logic and mathematics, as they occur in the human mind, are somehow either actual instantiations of those real entities in the world, or they somehow correspond perfectly to those entities in the world, so to our categories and our concepts. So this is sort of along the lines of the dogmatism that Stephen was talking about earlier. That position, now one way we can think about science, therefore, is that it's generating this type of knowledge. Right? And this is, and I think it's important to, when we step back and look at the cultural history of the relationship between Buddhism and science, one of the roles that Buddhism has played has been, especially recently, has been opening up inquiry into what is actually the nature of the human as a subject. Human consciousness, meditation research has moved into that direction, and I think it can be a very fruitful direction. But ironically, the sort of objectivist appropriation of science, which can be a naive belief, and scientists, you know, of course, when I say these kinds of things, last time I said this, there were a lot of scientists in the room, and most of them got mad at me for accusing them of being objectivists. Because apparently they're not, and I'm sure you're not, but the way we appropriate science, and it is ironic for reasons that will become clear, can be very objectivist, which we can think that science is producing knowledge about the world that is objective in the sense that it is completely independent of any particular human perspective. So one way of understanding an objectivist stance in general, and the way I'm going to appropriate that term, is that an objectivist stance is, within an objectivist stance, one can make knowledge claims that are true independent of who holds those knowledge claims, right? For example, if we say that water is H2O, it doesn't matter who thinks, who is entertaining that notion, who is working with that concept. If it's a scientist in Israel or in India or in Portland or some alien scientist out on Pluto, it doesn't matter. That concept somehow conforms completely to the nature of reality, the one true account of reality, and whoever is entertaining it, who says water is H2O, that statement is true. So there's a tendency, very interesting cultural tendency, to try to produce, and the logical positivism is part of this cultural tendency, to try to secure this kind of knowledge in science, which is a kind of knowledge in which basically human subjectivity disappears. Doesn't matter what your cultural background is, doesn't matter what language you are using, it doesn't matter where you studied mathematics or logic, doesn't matter where you studied psychology. Somehow, what you are learning is independent of all of that context, right? And the basic idea in the Buddhist context, especially in terms of the Heart Sutra that we said the mantra before, within the notion of emptiness, the claim here is that if we're trying to give an account of the ultimate nature of reality, we would use the kind of metaphorical term we use is emptiness, or shunyata in Sanskrit. And I'm not going to kind of give a full account of emptiness, but I want to give you one way of thinking about that that notion, which is to say, what is emptiness is saying along the lines of Nagarjuna's famous statement that that which is emptiness is interdependence. What yaha pratyucha samvat param shunyatam tam prachakshmahe, what one lesson of emptiness is the notion that there is no such thing as context-independent knowing. To know is to be in a context. To make a claim is always to make a claim in a context. To produce meaning is always to produce meaning in a context. Thus, one way of thinking about a kind of a purely objectivist claim would be a claim that would be transcontextually true. True in every possible context or every possible world or however way you want to put it. And the Buddhist notion here is that that is actually, is not a new claim, which is no truth is transcontextually true. You don't want to make that claim because then you're in a paradox, which is that if either that is transcontextually true, which is that in every possible context or every possible world, there is no truth that goes through all of them. But if that one does go through all of them, the claim that none of these are, there is no truth that is true in every possible world, then there is one. And this is the liar's paradox, right? So you don't want to say that. Emptiness or the account of the ultimate is not saying that this is the one true thing. Rather, it's saying that the very concept of a truly transcontextual objective truth is incoherent. You can't produce meaning, you can't produce truth without context sensitivity more particularly. So to be true is always to be true in context, to know is always to know in context. So, you know, one of the sort of ways in which that cashes out could be, well, can we just believe anything we darn feel like? And sometimes it sounds like James is almost saying that. But Dharmakirti and some other Buddhist epistemologists are a little bit more like Peirce, maybe. And also, perhaps this is another way of thinking about how we produce scientific knowledge as well. Which is to say, the idea of there being some kind of constraints, which was really very implicit in one of the things you said about Peirce, that there is. So in Dharmakirti's way of speaking about it, if we're going to produce sort of knowledge that what we mean by true or reliable knowledge, or a reliable cognition, a samyak jnana, the word knowledge is problematic, but if we say that something is a reliable cognition, for example, that's a fire. That reliable, what we mean by that it is causally efficacious. Specifically, that on the basis of that cognition, I am able to engage in an activity such that I achieve my goals. Right? So to know something true is to know what true really means here is true in the sense that I'm able to achieve what I wish to achieve. So one of the ways in which we immediately are in context is that Dharmakirti says you don't ever even engage in that process of inquiry unless you have what's called jijnyasa, which means a desire to know. You've got to have, this is very similar in some ways to the issue of doubt. You think there's something you need to figure out. You're cold, you need a fire. Is that a fire over there? You're going to inquire now. Without that sort of whole context, you're not going to produce knowledge. right? So that's one important way of us understanding the way in which science works, is that science also works institutionally and also on a personal level in that way, which I think is maybe why there isn't this kind of can't be this kind of convergence, is that because of the vagaries of personal taste and, you know, who's going to fund what and whatever else there might be in personal rivalries, scientists and institutions end up choosing certain types of topics and not other types of topics for their research. Right? So it's not the case that we're just sort of getting, you know, we're systematically exploring reality piece by piece. Okay, you do this part of reality and we'll do this part, and a couple of centuries later we'll compare notes. It doesn't work that way. So one of the ways that's very important for us to understand is that there are interests that are driving scientific research. So when and those interests between Buddhism and science are sometimes very different. And that's one very important thing to keep track of. Now, in Dharmakirti, of course, a lot of the type of acquisition of reliable knowledge that we just in a very straightforward way engage in is not through just a sort of direct sensory apprehension, but is actually through inference. And he, in fact, says that the two reliable modes of knowing or instruments of knowing are perception and inference, sensory perception and inference. And what happens in inference is that we first have to take our sensory perceptions and we have to categorize them. We have to create concepts. And those concepts are going to be based upon the causal characteristics of their objects. They don't capture all the causal characteristics. A concept that captured all the causal characteristics of its object would be a very unwieldy concept. You know, if I wanted to describe this thing in terms of all its causal characteristics, I'd probably need another millennium to do that, right? So I call it blue. I ignore a number of other characteristics in calling it blue. I'm ignoring it being shiny. I'm ignoring it being oblong and so on. I say, give me that blue object. So we're picking out certain causal characteristics that are relevant to our interests. And then his claim is that there can be relations, inferential relations among concepts, such that if I say that something is blue, then necessarily, for example, that means that it's also visible. So that's a certain kind of inference in his philosophy called a inference by way of essential characteristic, and it simply means that the when I have the causal characteristics in place that enable me to call this blue, I also have the causal characteristics in place that enable me to call it visible, a visually perceptible object, right? The key there is that blueness and visibility do not exist in the world. They exist only in, or even solidity, or any concept I form is a product of human cognition. There are no, he's a nominalist, so there are no universal properties. All properties are created through human cognition. Now the reason they work is if they are well formed, they connect with the causal properties of their individual objects. Now he has a sort of complex theory called the apoha theory or exclusion theory. I'm not going to go into the details of that. But the key lesson there is that when we are engaged in sort of inquiry in the world of this kind, it's an empirical inquiry. It's an inquiry that is looking at the causal effects of things and seeking to achieve our goals on the basis of those effects, ignoring concepts that don't work, right? That are not don't have this kind of causal traction. But there is a constraint in all of this, which is very important to recognize. And the constraint is actually whether or not we achieve our goal. So if we go back to the fire metaphor, if I see something across the other side of the field, I'm cold, I want to get warm, I see something over there, there's a famous example in Indian texts of a certain kind of flower that looks like fire from afar. So I say, oh, is that fire or is that crazy flower? And then I engage in an inferential operation, which is that I see smoke coming out. And if I've correctly identified smoke, then Dharmakirti's claim is that smoke's causal properties are only possible if it comes from a certain kind of an incendiary source. What that really means is that I can't form the concept of smoke unless the object I'm, the individual object I'm working with has certain causal properties that themselves are related to combustion. Okay? So I'm not, again, I'm not knowing real fireness and real smokeness and so on in the world. I'm forming concepts with my human cognition based on these causal properties. But the reason it works is that the concepts have traction on the causal properties. I can walk over, and then here's the key. When do I know that this is true knowledge in a certain way? It's when I get warm. And he calls this the moment of artakriya nirbhasa, the appearance of the accomplishment of the goal. Right? So that's a kind of final constraint, if you like. But here's the interesting thing that Dharmakirti says about that. So I've cold, I see something might be fire, I do a causal inference in this case, and I end up concluding that that must be fire. I walk over, and indeed my hand gets warm when I put my hand near that object, near that thing. So what's the confirmation here is actually a sensory appearance in my mind that I'm achieving my goal of becoming warm. Dharmakirti says that that is reliable, but it's not actually transcontextual. It is not true for all beings, because it is contingent on the particular kind of cognitive makeup that you have. So, for example, there are kinds of beings that can't perceive fire. There are who don't sense warmth. So in that sense, it doesn't make sense to say to the notion, this is fire, actually is not even intelligible for that kind of a mind. But more importantly, Dharmakirti is going to say that what a large part of what accounts for the reliability of that kind of knowledge is not some kind of causal tractability out there in the world, causal regularity out there in the world, but is actually what he calls drdha vasana in Sanskrit, which means firm imprints. In other words, we as a community of knowers share certain types of capacities. And in the way he would speak about it, it's karma, but it would really be a combination of what we would probably call biology and culture. So as a result of sort of sharing certain types of capacities in terms of our sensory faculties and in the way in which we use concepts and language, we experience that is as important in terms of its constraints and how we know as some kind of causal traction in the world. So here's the big implication. I hope that hasn't been too abstract. Here's the big implication. I do have a cold, so that's my excuse. But I think for me, I don't know if it's a big implication, but one very important implication, therefore, in the interaction with Buddhism and science is, first of all, to go back to the beginning, but also implied here, no account of the world is the final account. In fact, the very concept of a final account is incoherent. There is no explanatory system gives us the right answer in the sense of the final answer. Explanatory systems, scientific, Buddhist, whatever they might be, give us efficacious answers that enable us to achieve our goals. All of them are context dependent, but they have constraints. Constraints on what seems to be a world out there from the standpoint of your cognitive makeup. Dharmakirti, in the end, by the way, says, actually, there is no world out there. But that's a whole nother, I shouldn't go there. Never mind. Never mind. So what that means is, therefore, that the sort of community of persons producing knowledge together are not in a sort of invalid way, like we're making it up together, but actually they, in their knowledge practices together, are going to be part of the constraint of what it means for us to know the world. In a sense, we are producing the world we are knowing in a very significant way, just like an fMRI machine produces a bold signal. A bold signal is this blood oxygen level differential that is produced in an fMRI machine. It is not a natural phenomenon. Right? It only occurs because you run magnetic forces, energy through a person's brain, and then it happens. Right? It is an artifact of the system of measurement. In a way, for Dharmakirti, all knowledge is like that. The way we are knowing the world is productive of what we are knowing. So that means that if we're going to, so especially sort of Buddha's relationship to science, that piece of what I hope is wisdom in a way, the realization that it's that our knowledge is context dependent and that we are producing the contexts, sort of gives us the responsibility of being very cognizant of what that context is. You know, what kind of community of knowers are we producing together? So, thank you.